Can you reuse an N95 mask? How is supercomputing making a difference fighting a biological virus? And what does blood plasma have to do with a COVID-19 cure? These and many more questions may have popped into your head during this pandemic, and they're currently being asked by our scientists here at the lab. Let's go through some of the most recent updates on Livermore's work into COVID-19. You might remember our last video about this focused mainly on the COVID-19 High Performance Computing Consortium. This program puts many of the nation's best supercomputing facilities, including those here at Livermore, into the hands of scientific teams around the world. You can watch that whole video here to get up to speed, but since the Computing Consortium went live, teams at universities, companies, and research institutions all around the world have begun using Department of Energy supercomputing resources for tons of exciting projects, like mapping how virus-laden droplet clouds are transported and settle within hospitals and other indoor environments, or the rapid identification of potential antiviral compounds by simulating how they may interact with viral-infected cells, or deciphering the molecular mechanisms of the virus to better develop a vaccine. There's actually now a whole website dedicated to keeping an updated list of who is doing what with the consortium's resources, so check it out in the description box down below. It is absolutely fascinating. Now, what about masks? We're all wearing them when we're around people outside our family unit, and the kind called an N95 mask can be highly effective at blocking viral transmission. That's because the 95 in its name means that when it's worn properly, this kind of mask can block at least 95% of particles down to 0.3 microns in size. That means blocking a heck of a lot of potentially virus-laden droplets and even viral particles themselves. Again, this is only when the mask is worn properly, but they are an essential piece of equipment that can really reduce risk for healthcare personnel treating patients with the disease. And the problem is, there's a shortage. Now, it is always preferable to only use masks of all kinds once. But if we're not able to do that due to a shortage of supplies, then what's the next best option? A Livermore team has been exploring a three-headed question in relation to this. What solution can rapidly remove the viral threat, but not compromise the way the mask fits on the user's face, or leave a toxic residue that could harm the user? See, bleach and other disinfectants can damage the filter. UV light doesn't penetrate deep enough to fully disinfect the filter. You get the idea. It also makes sense to try and use something that hospitals already have on hand. Enter the lab oven. This is a humble piece of common lab equipment found in most hospitals that uses high temperatures to disinfect reusable items like surgical equipment. Early Livermore tests have shown that treatment of N95 masks with these devices does not compromise the fit, and so the team is going on to explore how much of a test virus similar to COVID-19 those lab ovens can successfully deactivate. Now, it's important to note that you cannot do this at home with your regular oven. See, lab ovens are specially designed to sterilize lab equipment, and used items are placed in specialized bags for decontamination so that the heat doesn't just make anything in those items float out into the world. So this is definitely an exciting step forward in exploring a possible scientific solution to mask shortages in healthcare settings, but it's also definitely a case of don't try this at home. And speaking of healthcare settings, LLNL has also developed an emergency response ventilator prototype in record time. It's like the equivalent of compressing a 6-year development process down to about 6 weeks. See, ventilators are machines that help keep COVID-19 patients alive by assisting with breathing if they're unable to do so on their own. And this device is intended as a stopgap until ventilator manufacturers can catch up to demand, which in itself is tougher than usual given the pandemic. This novel ventilator is born of countless hours of design, prototyping, and testing by LLNL engineers and scientists, many of them working from home like you and me, and outside clinicians and medical experts who all formed a team to respond to this shortage of ventilators. And the coolest thing about it is that to avoid competing with ventilator manufacturers while they catch up with that demand, this, again, totally new ventilator doesn't use parts already used to make hospital ventilators, which is an insane feat of engineering. It's kind of like asking someone to make a bike without using any parts currently used to make a bike. Along those same lines, the US has also experienced a shortage of the specific kind of nasal swab required for COVID-19 testing. Nationwide grassroots efforts turned to 3D printing to address this shortage. This kind of manufacturing allows rapid prototyping of hundreds of different designs and allows for immediate production to meet the increasing demand for testing. These swabs are highly specialized because they must withstand a variety of different mechanical forces. They have to be flexible enough to reach the cells in the uppermost part of the throat, but without damaging that tissue, and be rigid enough to allow insertion, rotation, and removal without breaking. The lab developed new testing protocols and was able to test more than a dozen proposed designs from various industry manufacturers, and then gave valuable feedback that improved those designs and enabled them to meet the requirements to be used in COVID-19 testing. See, testing is essential for disease tracking and outbreak containment, so providing a solution to a lack of one of the main tools necessary for testing is a huge help in keeping case numbers as low as we can. We're also putting our computing resources to work outside of the consortium. An LLNL team is using machine learning algorithms to find the best designs for antibody treatments. Antibodies are the molecules produced by our immune systems in response to infection, and they are tailor-made by our bodies to bind to a specific pathogen. They can be used as part of vaccines, but they can also be used as a treatment for some viruses by helping block the virus from entering new cells and helping your immune system clear the virus out of your body. Our bodies do make them, but they can also be designed in a lab setting. And that's great because it means that we don't have to rely on antibodies from the blood of patients who have already had the disease to potentially treat others. That's what you might have heard to referred as blood plasma treatment. By combining that machine learning, bioinformatics, experimental data, molecular simulations, and information about the virus's structure, the lab team was able to drastically narrow down possible antibody designs predicted to target SARS-CoV-2. Now, the worldwide academic community can compare these to natural antibody structures and see which are worth pursuing in the quest for possible treatments. And similar computing work is going into developing antiviral drugs. Using LLNL customized software, a lab team screened 26 million molecules against 4 protein sites. That amounts to a total of more than 100 million separate calculations to identify compounds that could possibly prevent infection or treat COVID-19 after someone's contracted it. We also now have a live website where you can explore all of our different COVID computational projects for drug and vaccine development, so check that out in the description box for more. And last but not least, the lab also has some unique rapid microbial detection techniques that are being adapted for COVID-19 use. But that's actually what our whole next episode is about, so I won't spoil it for you. Subscribe to this channel to catch that video when it comes out and for a new look inside the lab every single month. Check out our whole playlist of Inside the Lab videos here, and if you have questions about this work or anything else the lab is working on, let us know in the comments below. From the lab to you, we hope you're staying safe and well, and thank you so much for watching. I'll see you next time.